All along the Boche front line, black and yellow, white and grey puffs of smoke dance in mighty, cruel glee. Fountains of brown sand or black clay shoot up high, carrying with them bunches of stakes all tangled up with wire. The heavy shells throw back volumes of smoke some 300 feet in the air. It is a series of huge bangs, developing at times into a continuous roar. The whole air throbs with sound. It seems to come in sudden stabs. It was the 26th of June, 1916. From the relative safety of the British trenches, Major Walter Vignoles of the Grimsby Chums gratefully observed the British artillery pummeling the German positions to the north of the River Somme in northeast France. To the divisions of the British 3rd and 4th Armies under General Sir Henry Rawlinson, which manned the trenches in the sector of the Western Front, stretching from Gommecourt in the north to Montauban in the south, the effectiveness of the big guns was a matter of life and death. When the bombardment ended, supported by five French divisions in the south, they would be going over the top, pounding through the pockmarked wilderness of no man's land as fast as their 66 pounds of equipment would allow them. As they clambered awkwardly from their trenches, they would be praying that their artillery had accomplished its objectives, that enough of the enemy's strong points had been smashed, machine guns silenced, and vast tracts of barbed wire uprooted to give them the unopposed advance they had been promised by their commanding officers. The big push, which would eventually come to be known as the Battle of the Somme, was now only 5 days distant. For most of those waiting with mounting tension and excitement in the British trenches, this would be the first taste of battle. Having enlisted during the euphoric surge of patriotism which had first swept the nation on the outbreak of war, they would now be tested in one of the bloodiest and most controversial battles in the history of British military engagement. Many of them would not survive to take part in the passionate debate on the battle they were about to join. Their journey to the front had begun with a hoarse tumult of adoring crowds ringing in their ears. Now the cheers displaced by the thunderous roar of the bombardment, they were anticipating a famous victory. And to some commentators and historians, the Battle of the Somme would prove to be just that, a victory gained by noble self-sacrifice of committed idealists fighting for freedom and justice, which would swing the course of the First World War irreversibly towards an Allied triumph. A victory which would help to ensure a world that was safe for democracy and guarantee, at least for the moment, the integrity of small nations. To others, it would prove a senseless defeat, a defeat which would transform these naive patriots into the mud-spattered cannon fodder of incompetent generals struggling for the possession of a tract of meaningless wasteland. While the historical controversy still rages between these two viewpoints, There is one facet of the conflict upon which all commentators are agreed. For those who fought there, the Battle of the Somme was a nightmare, a dreadful carnage which produced over 600,000 casualties and burdened the survivors with sights and sound and smells which would haunt their waking and sleeping hours for the rest of their lives. The positions which the soldiers of the Fourth Army were to attack had been held by the Germans since the failure of the Great Race to the Sea in 1914. On the 4th of August of that year, having declared war on Russia and then France, the German High Command attempted to put into practice the plan of conquest conceived by General Schlieffen, their Chief of General Staff from 1892 to 1906. In defiance of Belgian neutrality, the German forces swept across its borders, meeting little resistance as the bulk of the Belgian army retreated towards Antwerp. The French and British were driven southwards as the German armies crashed through northern France. Crossing Le Mans, the German First Army, under General von Kluck, turned eastward to join up with the Second Army, under von Bülow, but found the troops of the Paris garrison threatening its left flank. As it turned right towards Paris to deal with this menace, a huge gap opened up between the two armies. The gap was spotted by the observers of the Air Force on their reconnaissance missions and reported to the Allied commanders. Into this breach, the British Expeditionary Force crept forward, hesitantly at first, but then with growing confidence. Von Kluck found himself unable to protect the rear, whilst von Bülow was intensely worried about his regiment's exposed right flank. Moltke, the supreme commander of the German armies, ordered a general retreat. To the hard-pressed Allied forces, now chasing the harassed German armies back across the Mall, it seemed that a miracle had occurred. Allied commanders felt that the war was over. They took wagers on the number of weeks it would take them to enter the German homeland. But then, as rapidly as it had begun, the retreat was halted. Having crossed the River Ain, the exhausted German troops dug themselves into prepared positions and turned their machine guns toward the Allies. Faced with such resistance, enthusiasm for the Allied advance rapidly petered out. And the British and French forces also began to construct their own lines of trenches. Along a line from the River Oise in the east to Nancy in the west, and from Nancy to the borders of Switzerland, the war of movement began to degenerate into the war of stalemate and attrition. The German armies realized that their Kaiser's promise that they would be home before the leaves had fallen was a trifle over-optimistic. And even the more moderate British hopes of spending Christmas by their own firesides were now in jeopardy. The whole of the Western Front now became solidified. Due to either natural barriers or fortifications in other sectors, the area immediately to the north and south of the River Somme was one of the few points where a decisive operation could be mounted. The big push would not arrive for another 18 months, but the scene for the great battle had already been set. While the nature of the war in France swung from the lightning movement of the summer to the dogged inertia of midwinter, back in Britain, the war had brought about one of the most remarkable social upheavals the nation had ever witnessed. Lord Kitchener of Khartoum, Secretary of State for War, had called for an increment of 100,000 volunteers to supplement the forces of the regular army. Within a month, over 500,000 had volunteered. Men jostled in queues, sometimes miles long, outside the recruiting offices for a chance to do their bit for Britain. W.T. Collier enlisted at the headquarters of the Artists' Rifles at Duke Street in Euston. His decision had been passionate and spontaneous.
My bosom swelled, and I clenched my fist. I felt restless, excited, eager to do something desperate for the cause of England. And then the impulse came, sending the blood tingling all over my body. Why not join the army now? Throbbing with a new vitality, as I imagine a man might who has just plighted his troth to the girl he had loved at first sight.
Recruiting became a cultural imperative. Politicians stamped the country, inciting their listeners to orgies of patriotic sentiment. Posters screamed out slogans such as, "Women of Britain say go," or most famous, "Your country needs you." Amateur and professional raisers sprang up, goading their audiences towards the recruiting stations with a potent oratory of passion and guilt. It was one of the most influential of one of these self-appointed agents, the Earl of Derby, who riveted the populations of Liverpool business offices with the assurance that he had Kitchener's personal guarantee that those who joined together served together. It proved a stroke of propagandist genius. Units of pals sprang up everywhere. Workplaces, football teams, villages and clubs joined up en masse. The seeds of patriotism broadcast by the recruiters had fallen on the rich soil of a nation's conscience and fertilized by our traditional belief in its own decency. As C.L. Montague was to write of these volunteers after the war,
each of them quite seriously thought of himself as a molecule in the body of a nation that was really, not just figuratively, straining every nerve to discharge an obligation of honor. All the air was ringing with rousing reassurances. France to be saved, Belgium righted, freedom and civilization rewon. A sour, soiled, crooked world to be rid of bullies and crooks and reclaimed for straightness, decency, good nature, the ways of common men dealing with common men.
Even though there were other factors in the rush to enlist, these were the sentiments embraced by the vast majority of the 3 million men who would eventually volunteer to fight. The frenzied response to the call for volunteers threw the whole supply structure of the armed forces into chaos. This new army had to be billeted, fed, trained and equipped. Uniforms were a luxury at first. Men were paid an allowance to continue to wear their civilian clothes. Rifles were also in short supply, and other implements had to be substituted during their training, which was largely limited to drilling and route marching. The sight of these platoons of earnest young men tramping in unison along the roadways of Britain, some in the now disheveled Sunday suits they had joined up in, walking sticks slung menacingly across their shoulders, would hardly have struck fear into the battle-hardened hearts of the German troops holding the line of the Somme. In the end, the training and equipping of this great influx of fresh warriors proved an intractable problem for Kitchener. Divisions which would eventually reach the Somme only received their full quota of equipment weeks before departure. Their preparations for the front also suffered terribly from the chronic lack of experienced officers and NCOs. This was a problem which permeated the whole volunteer army. The vast majority of those charged with the leadership of the newly formed divisions were commissioned because they had attended one of England's elite public schools. The meeting of these two nations of Britain was one of the most dramatic social encounters of the century. It was a meeting which forged a bond of sympathy that would have profound consequences in the post-war world. But for now, the only thing they had in common was their inexperience. Despite this, the morale of Kitchener's army never seriously flagged. The mutual support within the PALS regiments was tremendous. According to Private George Morgan of the West Yorkshire Regiment,
the companionship was marvellous, absolutely marvellous. Everyone seemed to help one another. It was lovely. We were all pals. We were happy, very happy together. And they were such good people. They were fine young men.
As the first substantial waves of volunteers reached the shores of France early in 1916, the plans for the big push were already underway. The huge volume of men, supplies and munitions being pumped forward on trains over 40 carriages long meant innumerable delays. In the winter months, it also meant the real possibility of freezing to death. There is nothing worse for an officer or man crossing to France for the first time or coming back off leave to take part in some important fight than his railway journey to the front, wrote Captain R.S. Coburn of the King's Royal Rifles. Following a series of failed offensives by the French at Artois and Champagne and the British at Loos, the commander-in-chief of the Allied forces, General Joffre, demanded a fresh joint offensive for the following year. The Somme quickly became the obvious focus of attention. The initial plan envisaged that 40 French divisions would attack from the south, with 25 British divisions advancing in the north. However, this reckoned without the German assault of Verdun. On the 21st of February 1916, the bombardment of the fortress of Verdun began. Lying at the head of a salient which the French line would have been better off without, Verdun was nevertheless a symbol of French national pride. It also became a major political symbol. If Verdun fell, so too would the French government under Briand. The fortress was to be defended at all costs. By the end of June, when fighting died down, 78 French divisions had been committed to Verdun. General Pétain, charged with its defense and later to become French commander-in-chief, vowed, "They shall not pass." They did not pass, but only at the cost of 315,000 casualties and the near mutiny of the French army. As the appetite of Verdun for fresh corpses grew more ravenous, so the number of French divisions available for the big push diminished. Ironically, this also increased the pressure from Joffre on Haig, the British commander-in-chief, to bring the date of the offensive forward. Politically committed to the defense of the fortress, Joffre felt that only a major offensive on another front would distract the Germans from their attack. By May, the total scale of the offensive had been substantially reduced. It was now agreed that on July 1st, approximately 12 British divisions would attack from the north, 5 French divisions from the south. The trenches which the Fourth Army occupied were typical of the British trench systems of the First World War. There were three or four lines of trenches from 100 to 400 yards apart. These lines were roughly parallel to each other. No trench ran straight for more than a few yards, which stopped the enemy from firing along its total length if one section were captured. Each trench had a parapet in front, facing out onto the barbed wire which guarded its approach. Fire bays alternated with solid earth traverses. The fire trenches were 6 to 12 feet wide at the top, narrowing to roughly 3 feet wide at the bottom. Communication trenches linked the lines together, and a wider approach trench allowed supplies and equipment to be brought forward after nightfall. The trenches required constant maintenance to prevent erosion. Pit props, railway sleepers, sandbags, and brushwood were some of the materials used to shore up their sides. According to Private Archie Surfleet of the 13th Battalion East Yorkshire Regiment, other materials might also be used.
The top step of our particular stinkhole consisted of a kind of soft bagging, which, when wet with rain, exuded a red fluid which trickled down the steps. We found it better to ignore it. Conjectures are not pleasant when you come across more than one boresore buried in sandbagging and forming part of the trench side.
Compared to the German trenches, the British were very crude affairs. This was a conscious tactic. According to the Field Service pocketbook,
the choice of a defensive position and its preparation must be made with a view to economizing the power expended on defense in order that the power of offense may be increased.
Nevertheless, until mid-1916, the Somme had not really experienced the full horror of trench warfare. When the bombardment opened on the 24th of June, this was about to change. Over the next 7 days, the German positions, cowering in their dugouts, were exposed to the earth-shattering impact of more than 1.5 million shells falling around them. The British field artillery was made up of 18-pound guns generally devoted to wire cutting, and 4.5-inch howitzers mainly deployed in trench demolition. The medium artillery, consisting of 4.7-inch, 6-inch and 60-pound guns, was targeted on supply dumps, approach roads and railheads. The heavy howitzers, ranging from 6 to 12 and 15-inch caliber, were used on fortified targets, such as the Germans' own gun emplacements. Further forward, the infantry used trench mortars to send 2, 3, and 4-inch shells into the enemy trenches. From the 26th of June onwards, the British began to mix gas projectiles with the high explosive and shrapnel-filled shells. Chlorine gas was one of the most terrifying weapons of the First World War. Lance Sergeant Elmer Cotton described its effects as splitting headache, terrific thirst, though to drink water is instant death, a knife-edge pain in the lungs and a coughing up of greenish froth off the stomach and the lungs, ending finally in insensibility and death. The color of the skin, from white, turns a greenish black and yellow. The tongue protrudes and the eyes assume a glassy stare. It is a fiendish death to die. Gas was in short supply and used only intermittently in the bombardment, most of it being saved for the morning before the offensive. The tactics of the coming battle were simple in the extreme. The memorandum, Training of Divisions for Offensive Action, dated 8th of May 1916, was under no illusions about the abilities of the volunteer army. Officers and troops generally do not possess the military knowledge arising from a long and high state of training which enables them to act promptly on sound lines in unexpected situations. The big push was to be based on the assumptions of this memorandum, that while a single line of men has usually failed, two lines have generally failed but sometimes succeeded, three lines have generally succeeded but sometimes failed, and four or more lines generally succeeded. The lack of training and experience was to be compensated for by sheer weight of numbers. The attackers would be organized into four successive lines of men no more than 100 yards apart. They would leave their trenches and advance along a front of about 15 miles, for a distance which ranged from just over a mile to 2 miles, depending on the disposition of the German lines. The advance would be protected by a creeping barrage of artillery fire, behind which the infantry were expected to advance relatively unmolested. The barrage would pound the first line of the enemy defenses for as long as it took for the infantry to reach it. It would then move forward to the next predetermined line and shell this for the same period. The barrage would continue forward in this manner, followed by the infantry, until the attack objectives had been achieved. The infantry on the Somme were led to believe that between the damage already inflicted by the bombardment and the covering fire of the barrage, their journey across no man's land would be little more than a stroll in the country. On the eve of battle, some were beginning to have serious doubts, but most were looking forward to the coming test of their manhood. Tommy Atkins was finally going into battle.
Tommy this and Tommy that, and Tommy way that side. But it's special terrain for Atkins when the trooper's on the tide. When the troop ship's on the tide, me boys, the troop ship's on the tide. It's special terrain for Atkins when the trooper's on the tide. Yes, making mock of uniforms, what guards you while you sleep? It's cheaper than them uniforms and their starvation cheap. And hustling drunken soldiers when they go in larger bits. Well, it's 5 times better business than parading in full kits. Well, it's Tommy this and Tommy that and Tommy, how's your soul? But it's a thin red line of heroes when the drums begin to roll. When the drums begin to roll, me boys, the drums begin to roll. It's a thin red line of heroes when the drums begin to roll. Well, we aren't no thin red heroes, no, we aren't no blackguards too. We're just single men in barracks, most remarkable like you. And if sometimes our conduct isn't all your fancy paints, well, single men in barracks don't grow into plaster saints. Well, it's Tommy this and Tommy that and Tommy fall behind. But it's please walk in front, sir, when there's trouble in the wind. When there's trouble in the wind, me boys, there's trouble in the wind. It's please to walk in front, sir, when there's trouble in the wind.
On the 1st of July, dawn came accompanied by a slight drizzle which quickly cleared to a bright sunny morning. The men ate a last meal. For the fortunate, this came warm from the rear positions. At 6:25, the artillery flung a final colossal roar of bombardment toward the German lines. Corporal Bill Mund of the East Surrey Regiment waited with mounting tension. How the time dragged on. Would it never come? At last, 1 minute to go. Get ready. Now for it. Either death or glory, or perhaps a nice wound, good enough to get us across the water to Blighty. Finally, the bombardment ceased. The whistles of the officers shrieked out along the front, and the Battle of the Somme began. Almost immediately, German barrage fire rained down with devastating accuracy on the British forward positions.
As our infantry advanced, down came a perfect wall of explosive along the front benches of my brigade and the 93rd. It was the most frightful artillery display that I'd seen. Each line disappeared in the thick cloud of dust and smoke, which rapidly blotted out the whole area. I saw a few groups of men through gaps in the smoke cloud, but I knew that no troops could hope to get through such a fire. The whole brigade was wiped out as a fighting unit.
This was the experience of Brigadier H.S. Rees, whose brigade of North of England pals attempted to advance at Serre. For those who survived the barrage, the machine gun fire was waiting. A sergeant of the 3rd Tyneside Irish described how...
I could see away to my left and right, long lines of men. Then I heard the patter-patter of machine guns in the distance. By the time I'd gone another 10 yards, there seemed to be only a few men left around me. By the time I had gone 20 yards, I seemed to be on my own. Then I was hit myself.
Up and down the line of advance, most of the British infantry came under heavy fire within seconds of leaving their trenches. For those who managed to win through to the enemy lines, there was often the heartbreak of attempting to find gaps in the German wire where none existed. All along the front, it was almost universally the same story of mayhem and carnage. The only sector of progress was south of La Boiselle, where divisions fighting beside the French and the French themselves made significant advances. The 21st and 34th captured long sections of German trenches, while the 7th, 18th and 30th divisions made serious inroads into their first day objectives. By 9 a.m., due to shock, exhaustion, counterattack, and German reinforcement, the vast majority of the British infantry had lost touch with their barrage protection. It had moved ahead to rain down shells on objectives which were not only unachievable, but also unreachable. Many battalions, having lost touch with their own barrage, were now cut off by the German barrage from receiving supplies and reinforcements. From behind the protection of their own lines, the enemy could pinpoint these stranded British remnants and attack them with mortar, grenades, and shells. Moving forward or to the rear meant exposing themselves once again to machine gun fire. Neither could they easily call on covering fire from their own artillery. though they had been issued with a miscellaneous collection of signaling devices, including flags, discs, and carrier pigeons, none of these proved adequate in the tumult of battle. The only communications which proved reliant, comprehensive, and fast enough to be effective were those carried by the regimental runners, who risked their lives scampering heroically back to their lines through the deadly hail of no man's land. Even after the slaughter of the first wave of attack, commanders were still sending battalions forward. The Newfoundland Regiment was ordered to advance towards Y Ravine at Beaumont Hamel, although the Enniskillen Regiment had already suffered 568 casualties there. The Newfoundlanders lost 710, including all their officers. When each regiment was only putting between 700 and 800 men in the field at any one time, such losses were staggering. Officers had been instructed to lead their men forward no matter what the cost. That 60% of them fell in combat over all divisions on July 1st is testament to the fact that they took this order quite literally. As the day dragged on, the carnage of the first few hours was repeated on a smaller scale throughout most of the field of battle. By nightfall, the Somme had claimed 60,000 British casualties, the highest number ever to fall in a single day. Nowhere had the attack approached the German second line, the main British objective for the first day of battle. The cost of this failure in human terms had been staggering. 20,000 human beings had died. When Corporal Joe Hoyles of the 13th Battalion Rifle Brigade approached the enemy positions 7 days later, he found that
the German front line was covered with bodies. They were 7 and 8 deep. They'd all gone black. The smell. These people have been laying here since 1st of July.
Acting Corporal Rupert Weber of the same regiment was transfixed by what he witnessed.
As far as you could see, there were all these bodies lying out there. Literally thousands of them. Some were without legs. Some were legs without bodies. Arms without bodies. A terrible sight.
For those assigned to burial detail, the task proved traumatic in the extreme.
The dead were stretched out on one side, one on top of each other, 6 foot high. I thought at the time, I should never get the peculiar, disgusting smell of the vapor of warm human blood heated by the sun out of my nostrils. I would rather have smelled gas 100 times.
For others, it was the sight of those who still lived which was unbearable.
It was the wounded that made the place such a hell. I did not mind the dead. I could do nothing for them. But one also felt incapable of doing much for the wounded.
The night of July the 1st, the British troops were forced to endure the eerie, demonic choir of those comrades' screams, babblings, cries, and moans echoing across the killing fields of no man's land. The effect on the nerves of the infantry was excruciating. Lieutenant Hornshaw of the West Yorkshire Regiment likened the noise to the sound of enormous wet fingers screeching across an enormous pane of glass. There were stretcher parties who braved the perils of the German machine guns to rescue some of the wounded, but as Captain Hertham of the Rifle Brigade agonizingly inquired, what was the use of a handful of stretcher bearers to deal with literally thousands of wounded? Even those who point to the advances on the south of the battlefront as evidence that the first day of battle was not a complete military disaster cannot avoid the catalogue of tactical and strategic criticisms laid against Haig and the rest of the British High Command. There was no intelligence that the German dugouts were so deep, their strong points so well fortified, and so many gun emplacements masked. Much of the British ammunition was made up of duds which failed to explode or exploded in the breaches of the guns prematurely. German personnel and positions withstood the bombardment relatively intact. Approximately 1 million of the shells fired during the bombardment were 18-pound shrapnel, which could do little damage to earthworks or barbed wire. The British gunners were very inexperienced and poorly trained. This led to inaccuracy not just during the bombardment, but in the barrage, which was meant to protect the infantry. Instead of advancing close behind their barrage, the infantry had to stand off for fear of being hit by shells dropping short. So the German defenders were given the opportunity to reorganize before the attacking wave of the British was upon them. The failure to inflict sufficient damage on the barbed wire was known by the infantry before battle commenced, but no intelligence about this was sought at command level. So orders from high command constantly assumed major gaps in the German wire. The battle plan was crude in the extreme. No attempt was made to disguise the imminent offensive, and there was no element of surprise when the attack finally came. At first it seemed that few lessons had been learned from the debacle of July the 1st. Solid lines of infantry continued to sacrifice themselves to German machine guns. Further military gains were minor and expensive. However, on the 14th of July, Rawlinson won permission from Haig to attempt a surprise offensive. Upwards of 20,000 men attacked the sleeping German positions at 3:25 a.m. After only 5 minutes of bombardment, 5 miles of the German second line were eventually overrun. Three divisions of cavalry then struggled through the pockmarked battlefield to form up in the open ground beyond the British advance. Lances glistening in the sun, pennants bravely waving, they gathered momentum as they advanced. Then, breaking into a charge, they thundered toward the German machine guns. The slaughter which followed signaled the pathetic end of the cavalry charge as a tactic in modern warfare. In mid-September, the Somme saw the introduction of a weapon which would eventually replace the cavalry and revolutionize the face of battle, the tank. At the Battle of Fleur-Cursalette in 1916, 49 of these 28-ton mechanical monsters lumbered towards their first offensive at a top speed of just over 3.5 miles an hour. With a crew of 8 squashed into the stifling heat of its armor-plated interior, the tank was designed to cross a 10-foot-wide trench and take out a machine gun post with 6-pounder guns or engage personnel with Vickers and Hotchkiss machine guns. On their first outing on the Somme, 17 of their tanks failed to reach the line of battle, and another 14 broke down or stalled in the mud once the battle commenced. 9 tanks survived to clear a path for their infantry, but the psychological impact of the tanks on the German defenders was out of all proportion to their numbers. By late September, the Germans had been pushed back over 3 miles. Weather conditions had become atrocious. According to the official history, little could be seen from the air through the rain and mist, so it was impossible to locate with any accuracy the new German trenches and shell hole positions. Bursts of high explosive were smothered in the ooze. The ground was so deep in mud that to move 1 18-pounder, 10 or 12 horses were often needed. The adverse weather was also affecting the work of the Allied Air Force, an increasingly important support for the infantry as the campaign on the Somme wore on. The tasks assigned to the Royal Flying Corps were wide-ranging and included counter-battery spotting, the destruction of enemy observer balloons, photographic reconnaissance of the battlefield, and the movement of supplies and reserves immediately beyond. The RFC used DH-2 fighter aircraft on offensive patrols, which engaged the German aircraft and cleared the air ahead of any infantry attack. This allowed the aircraft in the British rear to observe the battlefield and support the troops on the ground by strafing and bombing the enemy. The cost of this belligerent approach was immense. The RFC lost 782 aircraft over the Somme, while destroying 164 German planes and forcing down another 205. This apparent disaster was later defended by its commanders, who pointed out that the RFC's successes should be measured by its work for the army, not by its toll of enemy aircraft. The reason for the low German casualty rate was a result of hanging back beyond the line of battle and only rising to fight when they felt that the odds were in their favor. This gave the Allies complete aerial dominance over the battlefield throughout the offensive. The deluge over the Somme continued into October. It seemed that the big push was squelching ignominiously to a halt. But still the commanders ordered men forward in conditions which even the official history could not condone. The infantry, sometimes wet to the skin and almost exhausted before 0 hour, were often condemned to struggle painfully forward through the mud under heavy fire against objectives which were vaguely defined and difficult to recognize. Many of the troops now ploughing through the mud were beginning to question the wisdom of their leaders. With their growing knowledge of strategy and tactics came the realization that the extent of annihilation on July the 1st might well have been avoided. Their tendency towards cynicism was fed by newspaper accounts, which led them to question if the battle in which they were engaged was the same one being reported by the press. On July the 3rd, the Times quoted Haig as saying that the first day of the battle had brought substantial progress. We got our first thrust well home, and there is every reason to be sanguine about the result. According to the writer C.L. Montague, those who had lived through the massacre read the stuff open-mouthed. No amount of cynicism at the front could match the gall of some of those who wrote about the war from the comfort of their clubs in London. Even after the Battle of the Somme, Lord Northcliffe, owner of the Times, could write about conditions in the trenches.
The open-air life, the regular and plenteous feeding, the exercise, and the freedom from care and responsibility keep the soldiers extremely fit and content.
The volunteer army, had been poorly trained, roughly billeted, haphazardly equipped, and subject to the squalor of the trenches. They had borne all of this, for the most part, with a patient faith in their commanders, their government, and the institutions of the nation for which they fought. Now the fabric of their belief system was being rent asunder. Some of those who were joined up from a sense of decency and fair play, like Private Hubbard of the London Scottish, were now instructed to abandon these values.
We had strict orders not to take prisoners, no matter if wounded. My first job, when I had finished cutting some of the wire away, was to empty my magazine on three Germans which came out of their deep dugouts bleeding badly and put them out of their misery. They cried for mercy, but I had my orders.
Private, later Sergeant Hubbard, could never forget the incident. It was believed to be a major reason for his suicide some years after the war was over. While such orders were not common, indeed sometimes it seemed success was counted by the number of prisoners taken, neither was Private Hubbard's a singular experience. Idealism may not have perished on the Somme, but it was certainly grievously wounded. The horrors which the frontline troops had endured were being sanitized by the press for an ever credulous public. But the enormous emotion generated by the conflict had to find a voice somewhere. It discovered it in the songs and poems which emerged from the trenches of the Somme to menace the hallowed defenses of the establishment. The spearhead of this attack came from the pens of poets such as Robert Graves, Siegfried Sassoon, Wilfred Owen, and others, later to become known as the War Poets. Having enlisted with as much idealism as their comrades, poems like The General echoed the growing sense of bitterness and disillusionment which now began to gnaw at them.
"He's a cheery old card," grunted Harry to Jack, as they slogged up to Arras with rifle and pack. But he did for them both with his plan of attack.
The wounded soldier was not comfortably ensconced in a French hospital dreaming of his sweetheart and a swift return to duty.
He stirred, shifting his body. Then the pain leapt like a prowling beast and gripped and tore his groping dreams with grinding claws and fangs.
But the message of these poets was not just contained in their merciless descriptiveness. They celebrated life in the midst of death, the voice of nature struggling through the thunder of battle, and reasserted the sacredness of the individual against the wholesale degradation of anonymous mechanical warfare. Gethsemane, by Rudyard Kipling, granted the victim of warfare a holy, Christ-like quality.
The garden at Gethsemane, it held a pretty lass, but all the time she talked to me, I prayed my cup might pass. The officer sat on the chair, the men lay on the grass, and all the time we halted there, I prayed my cup might pass. It didn't pass. It didn't pass. It didn't pass from me. I drank it when we met the gas beyond Gethsemane.
The ultimate enemy of these poets and those they spoke for inevitably became not the German enemy, but the war itself. But still the war dragged on. While Haig had decided by mid-October that the German lines on the Somme would now not be pierced before spring, he was pressurized by Joffre to keep the offensive going. A final assault was planned. But the quagmire conditions underfoot saw its continual postponement. But on the 9th of November, the weather suddenly cleared, and severe frosts began to solidify the quivering mud. 4 days later, the attack began, an hour and a half before dawn. Each morning since the beginning of the month, the German frontline trenches had been subject to an hour's heavy barrage. However, the shells falling around them on the 13th were the prelude to the advance of 7 divisions under General Sir Herbert Gough. Along a line centering on Beaumont Hamel, 44,000 mostly battle-hardened British infantrymen thrust themselves toward the German position. The troops which now swept across no man's land were not the naive amateurs of July the 1st. Once through the barbed wire, they made maximum use of what cover the terrain had to offer, avoiding strongholds and attacking vulnerable positions in small groups. While the fortified town of Serre remained in German hands, everywhere else advances were spectacular. Beaumont Hamel, considered vulnerable to the British assault, was taken by the 51st Division. The 63rd Division took Beaucourt village and pressed further into German-held territory. By November the 18th, the Battle of the Somme was over. The Allies had advanced up to 6 miles. Each mile had been bought by over 100,000 casualties. The British suffered 450,000 casualties, all told. In the Second World War, the total of British losses on all fronts would not exceed 350,000. Whatever its strategic value, in human terms, the Somme had been a military disaster. Those who joined together had indeed fought together and died together. Remote districts of Scotland, Welsh mining towns, and industrial Midlands villages found a whole generation of young men wiped out at a stroke. The survivors would bring back tales of incompetence and horror, which would alter the thinking of the British public forever. The memory of what they had witnessed could only grow more vivid with time. Having fought in this most harrowing of battles, they felt charged with the responsibility somehow to communicate the pathetic, murderous indignity of the Somme to their fellow countrymen and to future generations. Do you remember the dark months you held the sector at Mammoths? The nights you watched and wired and dug and piled sandbags on parapets? Do you remember the rats and the stench of corpses rotting in front of the front line trench? And dawn coming dirty white and chilled with a hopeless rain? Do you ever stop and ask, is it all going to happen again? Do you remember that hour of din before attack? And the anger, the blind compassion that seized and shook them as you peered at the doomed and haggard faces of your men? Do you remember the stretcher cases lurching back with dying eyes and lolling heads? Those ashen grey masks of the lads who once were kind and keen and gay. Have you forgotten yet? Look up and swear by the green of spring that you'll never forget.